serpent, the young gecko from Rodrigue. The sun shines fiercely in the sky in Pointe Coton, Rodrigue. Rain seldom come, unless brought by force with a cyclone. It then pours in torrents and wreaks havoc everywhere. On the Snake Island, further along the coast, lived Tisserpent, a young gecko. He preferred to stay in the shade in tree bark and grooves at the roots of casuarina trees and bushes. When he traveled to the main island on board of boxes of foodstuffs, he could not peel his eyes from the unfurling landscape. Visitors often travel there to look after the fauna and flora. Captivated by the views, Tisserpent would feel happy as they would make their way up the lush green hills and down up again past ravines. Surprising glimpses of the stunning blue and green lagoon would emerge sparkling in the sunshine as they rounded a bend. They passed a landscape punctuated by lone palm trees and brightly coloured chattel houses. Fields were heavy with produce as people worked the land. Exotic trees lined winding roads, brightened with pops of colours, scattered everywhere from tropical flowers. Rodrigue was like nowhere he'd been before. Not that he'd travelled much, but it was enough for him to have toured it all. The island is volcanic, and the view from the highest point, Mont Limon, out to the protected lagoon is simply dazzling. A decent spell of rain had created an abundance of lush vegetation. Most produce is homegrown, so the islanders welcome the extra rainfall, which can be scarce. Farming and fishing are the main sources of income, along with a small but growing tourist industry. After a warm welcome at their usual guest house, La Belle Rodriguez at Pointe Coton, Tisserpent wandered down the beach, just a minute's walk from the cool ceiling of the veranda. Some goats greeted him with indifference at the guest house gate, but scampered away bleating in panic as soon as he got closer. On the beach, he sat on a rock worn smooth by the ocean and soaked up the beauty of the clear turquoise water of the lagoon. It felt warm and nice. Just him, the sea, and a lone cow out on a stroll on the pale sand. This was perfect paradise. An old lady passing by, sweating under the heat, came on near the rock where Tisserpent was basking and looked for a spot to sit down. The gecko moved to a small crevice, waiting to see what happens next. She looked very tired and thirsty. Tisserpent hesitantly asked the lady, "Are you thirsty, ma tante? I know a spring nearby where you can find sweet, refreshing, cool water. Would you like me to show you?" The lady looked around to see who was talking to her. Seeing no one, she searched around the lagoon in case it was one of the fisherwomen hiding to skew an octopus on their line. She saw no one. Sometimes the sea breeze can make you hear your own voices, just like the conch. "Maybe my thirst is too strong," muttered the old lady. Tisserpent came out from his crevice and said again, "Ma tante, follow me. You can also find ripe mangoes and bibas near the spring you can eat. Maybe you're also hungry." The well-willing gecko clicked loudly. The lady took notice and turned around to it. "Is it you who is talking to me?" "Oui, ma tante, it is me, Tisserpent. I come from the Snake Island. And I saw you looking tired and thirsty. I often come here and know the place. I just wanted to help." "Oh, you a mauvaisier? How can you talk like humans?" No. I'm just a gecko, ma tante. I have been in the company of man for a long time enough. Listen to their conversations and learn to speak like them. You see, we geckos like to be like that, and I love traveling, jumping in their boxes. Humans take to the main island. It's my only way to travel. When the humans moor the boat, I take a wander around, meet other creatures, have a chat, then go back to my home when the boat returns. You are a clever little gecko and talkative too, but I'm sure you're a mauvaiseur. You see, animals don't talk unless they are possessed. You won't harm me, would you? I know a good spiritual healer, you know. He could whip you in no time out of your shape-shifting game. Ma tante, if I was a mauvaiseur, would I offer to help you? Tisserpan started to feel a bit miffed. This lady was way too suspicious of his good intentions. But she got up after a few moans and asked to follow him. Tisserpan took her to the spring. As they hiked through the woodland filled with flowers and chirping birds, they climbed rocky paths leading to the coast. They came to a rocky entrance, which looked like a cave. Now, where have you brought me? I knew you were a mauvaiseur and planned to harm me. That's why you've taken me to this cave, exclaimed the lady in fright. No, ma tante, the spring is inside. Come and you will see. Somehow, the lady followed the gecko, and what she saw struck her in great surprise. First, the cave was very cool, a welcome relief from the scorching heat outside. Eerie rock formations called filled the whole cave and the cavern with stalagmites, stalactites, and water crystals which shone like diamonds in the obscurity. They heard a water gurgling far and soon reached an enlightened spot where a pool of crystal clear water invitingly summoned the thirsty lady. She threw her bag on the ground and plunged her face to refresh it and started drinking, avidly lapping loudly. When she stopped, she turned to the gecko and thanked him. So, I'm not a mauvaiseur after all, am I? She said, I tell you, Tisserpan, we humans have been told that only us have been granted the boon of speech by the Creator. Anyone else who is non-human is potentially a mauvaiseur. That's what my mothers used to say. The two chatted over life and what they had seen around them. Ma tante told Tisserpan he should visit her home. The happy gecko agreed and left for his veranda. On the way, he touched his claws to the gentle wavelets. They felt wonderful, so he allowed himself to be rolled in them. It was so much fun. Deliciously warm waters made it hard to leave the sea. When the sun started to set over a glorious orange and golden sky, he retreated to dry itself on one rock by the shore. A crab digging in the nearby sand hole noticed him and called, "Hey, gecko, how come you can swim and not drown? I have been watching you for a while. Are you a mauvaiseur? As geckos don't swim." "Now, why would I be a mauvaiseur only because I'm a gecko and can swim?" Tisserpan replied immediately, exhaling a long, tired, loud click. "I'm a crab, which has seen hundreds of tides and in and out, countless waves crashing during cyclones and peaceful days over a sunny day. Never have I seen a gecko coming to swim. Well, I am now. I have lived with humans for long enough and learned to swim like them too." "Oh well, you sound a very smart gecko indeed. Now, can you help my friend Carole the octopus? She can swim, but has been hiding under the rocks because the fisherwoman will hunt her down and spare her to death." "Why so?" exclaimed Tisserpan in horror. "Because humans are hunting the octopus too much, without enough time for any of us to grow big and reproduce. Soon there'll be none of us left. Carole has promised to be with her companion, Ticolo, but she can't find him either. She's not left her hiding place for weeks now and is very hungry. Do you think you can help her?" "Me? Help her? But how?" "Maybe you can understand when the humans would be coming and alert us so we can save her from being killed." Tisserpan did not know what to do, But his kindness and empathy were awakened, and he promised the crab to help Cajon. He took the crab to the inner shore where the mangroves grew and showed him some leftover foods for Cajon. So Cajon, the octopus, was fed. Next remained how she could be saved. That night, Tisserpan slept with one eye open, inspecting the humans at their slightest movement. In the morning, he heard the men talking while having breakfast.
Today, we have to attack this region. It's been too much now. They're overfishing the lagoon.
How do you think you're going to ask the octopus fisherwomen to stop?
I know how.
The sun was already getting to a dull melting point, although the frequent sea breeze cooled down immediately. Tisserpan made his way to the spot where he met the crab. Crab! Crab! Where are you? Winkles, have you seen crab this morning? The Winkles replied in unison. Yes! He came out of his hole, but went back in again. Gecko felt he would roast dry on the dark basalt rock and become crisp. It's me, Crab. So, do you bring good news? He heard a small voice behind him. Yes, I heard them. They are stopping all fishing in this part today. Maybe Cajon is saved. Really? That's very good news indeed. Thank you, Gecko. If you ever need help from me, just come and call me. With this, the crab disappeared in the sand. That day, Gecko perched itself in the shade of some coconut trees and rocks and watched. The men went walking to the fisherwomen when they waded their way into the lagoon. A few arms in the air, some loud voices showed their disapproval. But after a while, they came out. Gecko was pleased. This is definitely sure that Cajon is safe now. She can go and look out for Ticolo. That evening, Gecko climbed up his favorite corner in the veranda's ceiling. He waited to hear what the men talked about. He was also perplexed as to how they could persuade the women so easily.
I have to admit that a lie like that is well worth it sometimes, if it can help someone. Your story of the sharks in the lagoon was very good. Indeed, it's a valid one. It's a lagoon, and it can have sharks. The people here have been lucky for long never to encounter sharks, but anything can happen. The fright can allow us to have enough time to devise a way to compensate them. After all, they fish for a living.
From that day onwards, racks of octopi splayed drying out in the sun disappeared. The locals were warned they could be fined heavily if caught fishing again. New laws and enterprises came forward to help those who had to leave fishing to find a new job. Crab often thinks of Tisserpan, and the latter still makes the crossing from the island to the mainland. He still enjoys traveling and listening to humans while taking in the beautiful surroundings.